This episode is brought to you by Dr. T's Primary Care for Men. Get back your pride. Call them 956-441-2188. This episode is brought to you by the Law Offices of Rene A. Flores. Hashtag DWI Expert.
Hey, this is your Olympic hero, Kurt Angle, and watch hashtag HPV.
No, it's hashtag PVT.
PVT.
HPV is a sexual disease. Yeah. You're right. Yeah, human papillomavirus.
Yeah. This guy's the chemistry guy over here, right?
Oh, what was that?
Hashtag PVT.
And watch hashtag PVT?
Yeah.
Hey, this is your Olympic hero, Kurt Angle, and I want you to watch hashtag HPV.
No, it's PVT.
Oh, my God.
That's great.
This is your Olympic hero, Kurt Angle, and I want you to watch hashtag PVT. Oh, it's true. It's damn true.
All right, hashtag PVT, what's up? Rock and Roll James along with Chaz Corona on location today. We're at Mission Parks and Rec, the RGV Sports Show, and we've got Kurt Angle here with us. How you doing, Kurt?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on.
You're looking great, man. You look lean. You got veins coming out and everything, bro. How you been?
I'm doing well. I've been working out a little bit harder and dieting a little better, so trying to take care of myself.
Is there something that you're working out for, or
no, specifically, or is it healthy in general?
Yeah,
especially with my knees, and my back. You know, if I gain too much weight, I have a lot of stress on my knees, so
yeah.
I'm trying to keep myself lighter.
Yeah, man, you've had quite a career, man.
Thank you.
You know, and it was interesting when you came into the WWE from the Olympics, you know, and winning that gold, and you know, you had the Olympic gold character, and then it just turned into comedy genius, dude. what was the plan? Were you supposed to be a babyface? What did they tell you before you debuted? This is what we're going to aim for.
Well, I think Vince McMahon had an idea from The Rock. When Rock was started out, Vince tried to make him a babyface.
Okay.
On purpose, mm-hmm. And it backfired.
Okay.
So he used the same formula on me, knowing it would backfire. So he wanted me to be a heel. That's what he wanted off the bat. So that's what we shot for. A lot of people think that the fans went against Vince. They actually didn't.
It was all part of the mastermind.
Yeah, it was all part of the plan.
That's crazy. Yeah. You know, one of the most memorable matches was when you introduced John Cena, man. I mean, I don't think anybody else could have done that but you, man, because you played it perfectly. It was great. It was funny. It was like, it was just awesome, man.
Yeah, John Cena's a great athlete. He's a great guy and one of the best talkers in the business. So I knew after that night, I knew he was going to be a huge star. I knew he would end up being the top guy in the company eventually.
Yeah. Before the promo happened, did you already kind of get a feel on this guy? Like, hey, I have a good feeling about this guy? Or it was just kind of like, well, we'll see what happens.
No, I spent very little time with him before that promo. We just talked over the match a little bit, and we just went out there and cut the promo and turned into the wrestling match. And I didn't know we were going to have that great of chemistry. So that just shows how good John was back then when he actually started out. So that's saying a lot about John.
When you were training for the Olympics, did it ever cross your mind you were going to, you know, cross over to, you know, professional?
No, the opposite. Yeah, I was always told growing up to stay away from, don't watch pro wrestling. It's fake. You're the real deal. And a lot of amateur wrestlers take pride in that. Mm-hmm. And because pro wrestling calls themselves pro wrestling and amateur is the level underneath, that's not true. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you got real wrestlers and you have pro wrestlers.
Yeah.
One sports entertainment, one's real sport. And I think once the wrestlers realized that Vince McMahon got away from calling it pro wrestling and said it was a sports entertainment, mm-hmm. they jumped on board. So there are a lot of amateur wrestling fans that love sports entertainment or pro wrestling, whatever you call it.
Growing up, like, who inspired you? Or, like, did you ever watch wrestling before
pro wrestling?
The Olympics?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, you know.
Very little. Bruno Sammartino was from Pittsburgh, so we took a lot of pride in Bruno. I was a big fan of his, and I really, I actually watched him wrestle one time against Larry Zbysko at the Civic Arena in Pittsburgh, and it was pretty cool. I was an amateur wrestler, so I thought it was kind of stupid. I was there at the time, but it was really cool to see the fans backing Bruno the way they did. It was, you know, it opened my eyes a little bit, and you know, you don't realize, you know, 20 years later, I was in the WWE doing the same thing as Bruno.
That's crazy. I wanted to ask you, one of the things you're famous for is for saying, hey, I won a gold medal with a broken freaking neck.
Right.
How did you break it? And what exactly was broken? And how did you persevere to keep winning?
Well, the Olympic trials started with the U.S. Open, and I was wrestling in the semifinals. I got thrown on my head, and I broke my neck. I didn't know it at the time, so I kept wrestling. And I came from behind, won that match, and I had to win the U.S. Open finals to get a bye to the finals of the Olympic trials. So I continued to wrestle, even though my neck was killing me. And I won by referee's decision in the U.S. Open finals. And that put me in a good position in the Olympic trials to be in the finals of the trials. Because if you're U.S. Open champion, you go directly to the finals of the trials. And the second through sixth place winners wrestle in the mini tournament. The winner of that mini tournament wrestles the U.S. Open champion in Olympic trials finals. So long story short, I went home after that match, and I had an MRI and an X-ray done, and my neck was broken. I had four broken vertebrae in my spinal cord. I had three discs sticking directly in my spinal cord. So it was a serious injury, and the doctor said, I think you're done. I said, I can't be done. We have to figure a way of me coming back. He said, well, how long do you have before the trials? I said, 2 months. He said, we might be able to make that work. So the doctor gave me this healing agent that was non-steroidal because you can't take steroids in the Olympics. We got tested quite a bit. And he had a doctor travel with me. And before each match at the trials, the doctor would stick me with 12 shots of Novocaine in the neck to numb the pain. So I couldn't feel my neck. And it worked incredibly well. It made me forget about my neck for that, 8 minutes. Mm-hmm. And I did that throughout the trials and then the Olympics. And that's how I got the gold medal. I won a gold medal with a broken freaking neck.
That's crazy. Incredible. Did you have to work really hard at being funny, dude? Because it seemed like you were just natural, a natural comedic talent. Did that come from as you were growing up as a kid? You know, making people laugh in class,
No, I wasn't a funny kid. But the crazy thing is, they kept directing me that way. Uh-huh. Like Vince McMahon, the writers, they kept wanting me to be this goofball, corny nerd, Olympic gold medalist that drinks milk and preaches the three I's. And I caught on to it, and I enjoyed doing it. I enjoyed making a dumbass out of myself.
But getting into character's not easy, man. And you portrayed that character really well, and you were willing to go wherever you had to make it.
I was pretty brave. Yeah. I made an ass of myself many times. So I definitely stuck my neck out there quite a bit.
Did you come up with any of the ideas, or were they all kind of suggested to you?
They were all suggested to me. We had a writer named Brian Gewirtz. Dwayne The Rock Johnson actually hired him to be a writer for his production company. He took him away from the WWE. That's how good Brian is. Uh-huh. Brian wrote all my material. He was incredible.
So he came up with the word, hey, bucko.
Yes. Every word I said.
Wow, man. That's
incredible. I copied it. Whatever he told me to say, I would say.
What is the thing that people tell you the most when the fans meet you and they want an autograph? What do you hear over and over that is a reoccurring theme or story?
Well, you know, they talk about a lot of my great matches I've had, but most importantly, what I do hear more is the moments. The milk truck incident, mm-hmm. the cowboy hat incident, the battle rap with John Cena, my Hall of Fame speech. So it's not necessarily the wrestling. They love the wrestling and they'll remember it forever, but it's the moments, the huge moments that you give those fans that they remember you forever. I'll give you an example. A bad moment is when Brock Lesnar fell short of the shooting star press and landed on his head.
That was in Seattle, right?
You know, that's a moment everybody never forgets.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Everybody brings it up. You know, everywhere I go, it's, hey, did Brock, was that a botched spot? Yeah, obviously. Yeah. So It was pretty serious.
And anybody other than Brock would have probably, you know, broken their neck in that fall, man.
You're absolutely right.
Because Brock's a beast, dude.
He is a beast.
Yeah.
It'd be hard to break his neck.
Yeah. So have you been doing a lot of cross-country, appearances and stuff like that lately?
I just started about a month ago. They're starting to open up.
Because
I was doing a lot of virtual signings and virtual appearances over the last year and a half. But it's kind of nice opening up and being able to go places and see your fans personally.
Mm-hmm. And what exactly are you aiming for now that everything's kind of opened up? Do you have anything to do with any type of federation or any type of organization?
Not right now. I want to take a break away from that. I'm doing a podcast, The Kurt Angle Show, and I also run a supplement company, Physically Fit Nutrition. We have a great product called Chicken Snacks. They're selling really well. Incredible flavors, 11 different flavors. It's engineered chicken breast and organic plant protein. We have the Chicken Snacks and the Snack Smart organic plant protein, and we flavor them. So it's high protein, low carb, low fat, very healthy, great flavors. Barbecue, sriracha, kung pao, cinnamon swirl, sour cream and onion. There are a lot of great flavors, but you go to physicallyfit.com to get your order. They're incredible.
Mexican enchilada flavor or anything like that?
Yeah, the only thing we have close is sriracha.
So I guess we can't invite you to go have some botana platters or anything like enchiladas.
We could try to add a special flavor, yes.
Yeah, well, that's great, Kurt, man. We really appreciate you coming down to South Texas. Where are you residing now? Where are you living at?
I live in Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh?
Yeah, we're trying to.
You're a Steeler fan?
Yes, yes, a big Steeler fan.
Cowboys, man. Dallas Cowboys, man. Come on.
Well, they have a long history together.
Yeah, yeah, they do. Going back
especially the 70s.
Man, those were great times back in the 70s.
Yeah, we hated you guys.
Yeah, man. Mean Joe Green, Rocky Blyer, all those excellent.
A lot of Hall of Famers on that team.
Franco Harris,
yeah.
Before, so you did win an Olympic gold medal, and then you did get into the WWE. But hypothetically, let's say you didn't go into WWE. What were you envisioning for the rest of your life? What did you want to do?
Mm-hmm. Well, I was a business major in college, and the last year I had to give a couple of presentation classes. And back then, I didn't like standing in front of people, so I didn't want to take them, so I asked my advisor, I said, what else can I graduate with? And he said, well, for the last 3 years, I've been putting you in your free elective classes. You've been taking education classes. And he said, I lined you up to have an education degree without you knowing. So I took a couple more of my classes for education. I graduated with an education degree, and I figured I would coach college. I was also thinking about getting my MBA to be a professor in college so I could teach in college as well. So that was my goal after the Olympics. So if this didn't happen, eventually I would end up teaching. I probably would have went on a nice media tour after the Olympics and, rode the wave of endorsements until I couldn't.
What are your thoughts about the Attitude Era? You know, you went through all that, man, and
it was a
different
time.
When you think
time.
Back in that era of your life, what comes to mind, for you?
It was really exciting. The ratings were really high. We were having the battle with WCW. Pro wrestling was at its peak. Mm-hmm. It's the highest it's ever been in its history, especially with the ratings. And it was because WWF and WCW were battling. And it was a really exciting time to get in. There was nothing that was politically incorrect. Mm-hmm. So you could do whatever you wanted, say whatever you wanted.
Talking about that.
Yeah, it's different now. You can't do that stuff. And back then, a lot of wrestlers were working with injuries. It was a little more, they didn't have a drug policy back then in the Attitude Era. So it got a little ugly at times. Mm-hmm. But other than that, it was a great time.
Well, this past Monday night, Monday Night Raw achieved its lowest rating ever for a post-4th of July Raw, and it seems like it just keeps slipping. You think AEW has anything to do with that, or Just there's more competition or there's less people watching television?
Well, there are a lot of shows to choose from. Uh-huh. You can I think you get TNA on the Fight app, and mm-hmm. you can get Ring of Honor, you can get New Japan Pro Wrestling, AEW, just so many choices. So a lot of these fans are dispersing to other territories or the other companies, and I think that WWE... They need a little bit of a spark. They need something. Roman Reigns has carried the train for a long time. I think they need another big superstar.
What do you
like
think
Roman.
Of his heel turn? Do you think it's working for him?
Yeah, it should have been done a long time ago.
Was training to be in the ring for pro wrestling easier than you thought, or was it way harder than you thought it was going to be?
Well, it wasn't like Olympic training.
Right, yeah.
It wasn't as intense. But no, the training was really difficult. When I started, I did the Dory Funk Dojo, and we were practicing. We would go up to WWE 1 week a month, and they would beat the hell out of us. We would have to bump 300 times a day. You bump, it's plywood, just like this. Mm-hmm. You're bumping on hard material, and you do that 300 times, you're going to get really sore. Yeah. And It was really difficult. The physically, from a being sore standpoint, I wouldn't say from a workout standpoint, but from a beating up your body standpoint, it was pretty bad.
WWE released kind of instantly without, and shockingly, Braun Strowman and then Aleister Black, who just came out on AEW as well this past week. What do you think was the cause of all that, man?
I have no idea. I'm not sure.
Did
why
you see
they
Braun
release.
Strowman like getting was like the big
no,
guy?
No,
I
never
about.
Thought he would ever get fired. But things happen. It could be because they wouldn't agree to a contract, or his contract was up, and the WWE felt they were paying him too much. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of facets to it, so we don't know anything really. Mm-hmm.
Do you keep up with wrestling? Do you watch any of the
little
product?
Bit, yeah, I watch WWE every once in a while.
Is that the only product AEW. You watch?
No, I watch AEW too at times. If I'm in front of the TV and it's on at that time, I watch it.
There's been a lot of surprise appearances, like Aleister Black, and then you have a lot of WWE former guys coming in and just
that's always going to happen. Yes.
Do you think that'll ever happen with you? I mean, do you think you'll?
I don't know. I haven't really given much thought.
Is your body good enough to go in there and?
Oh, I can't wrestle now. No. That's not happening. Yeah, that's long gone. Yeah.
So it has to be in a management position, microphone work, selling
something
the
different,
character,
yes, or commentary,
putting him over and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you'd do great. And as a booker and an agent as well, would you ever think of doing anything like that?
Nah. No? I don't want to do that part of the business. It's too difficult.
Yeah. Wow.
There's the athleticism, and then there's the personality component. Can you train someone to bring out their personality, or they got it or they don't? How do you weigh that?
I think it's teachable, but I think you have a little bit of it inside of you. You have to make it part of you. Mm-hmm. Your personality. If you went over the top in your personality, what would it be like? And I think it is teachable, but I think part of it has to be hereditary, definitely.